What have I ever done to deserve even one of the pleasures I've known? Tell me, Lord, what did I ever do that was worth loving you or the kindness you've shown? Lord, help me, Jesus, I've wasted it. So help me, Jesus, I know what I am. But now that I know that I've needed you, so help me, Jesus, my soul's in your hand. Try me, Lord, if you think there's a way I can try to repay all I've taken from you. Maybe, Lord, I can show someone else what I've been through myself on my way back to you. Lord, help me, Jesus, I've wasted it. So help me, Jesus, I know what I am. But now that I know that I've needed you, so help me, Jesus, my soul's in your hand. Lord, help me, Jesus, I've wasted it. So help me, Jesus, I know what I am. But now that I know that I've needed you, so my soul's in your hand. Jesus, my soul's in your hand.
As I mentioned, as we gathered in the Harvey Room, my name is Dave Foley, and Donald's family has done me this incredible honor of asking me to be the celebrant here today. I want you to know that we are not going to be hard on formalities here. Don was not the kind of guy who'd like a man in a suit standing up and trying to make everything into a ceremony. So we're gonna try to do this to honor Don. We're gonna celebrate. I know that if I asked any one of you to tell me about the Don, Donnie, DK, that you knew, it would be a different answer from what the person beside you would give me, because we know one another differently depending on when we cross paths, the circumstances of our lives, and how we interact. I know that what we do will not be as full as it could be. We're not going to linger unnecessarily, but we're also going to take as much time as it takes to do and to say what we need to do and say to honor this man who has blessed us all so much with his presence in our lives. You all know that at the conclusion, we will not be going to cemetery or crematorium. That will take place at a later date. It was suggested by Reiner and Sherry that right now at the beginning of our time together, we could stop and have a word of prayer. I'm going to invite you, whether you believe or not, to bow your heads and your hearts and allow yourself to relax and be calm. And I'm going to speak a prayer. Heavenly Father, there is no way that we can tell you with honesty that we are doing something that we want to be doing. Every fiber of our being says, no, this can't be, this won't be. And yet we know it is, it will be. So while we can be pleased for Donnie that he's past all of the pain and all of the limitations that he experienced so much in the last weeks and months of his life, we're glad that he's past that. But Father, we can't be completely glad. In fact, all we can recognize right now is how much it hurts. We're separated, a life is gone, and we're still here. So I just pray simply for each person who's gathered here, especially for Don's family. Will you please, by the presence of the Holy Spirit, speak peace to us? Help us to make sure that at the end of our time together, we're going to be at least satisfied that we have celebrated this truly remarkable young man. I pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. It was suggested, and I think it was a good suggestion, that I read the obituary to you today. You will be aware of the fact that there are people joining us through the broadcast of this service. And we do say welcome to them as much as to those of us who are gathered here. I'm just going to read briefly the obituary. Donald Kenneth Mortensen, aged 43 years of Moose Jaw, Saskatchewan, passed away on Sunday, March 7th, 2021. He was predeceased by his grandparents, Anne and Ken Williams, his grandmother, Shirley Mortensen. He is survived by his loving and devastated mother, Sherry Mortensen, his father, Reiner, and his daughter, Charlie, forever in his heart. Donald was the oldest of four children and is survived by his brother, Joshua Mortensen, his sister, Anne Maria Mortensen, with her husband, Brady, his nephews, Ryder and Jansen, his niece, Ella Lee, and by his sister, Sarah Kay, and her husband, Nathan, his niece, Taylan, and nephew, Jacob. He will also be remembered by his aunt, Casey Endicott, with her husband, Lyle, his cousins, Dennis and Kyle, his uncle, Randy Williams, and his sons, Robert and David, his aunt, Bev Arons, with her husband, Ray, and his cousins, Raymond, Adam, and Chuck. By his aunt Joanne and her husband Tim, his cousin Richard Williams, his uncle David Mortensen and his wife Rhonda, Brody and Maya of Humboldt, Saskatchewan, his grandfather Harold Mortensen of Penticton, BC, as well as numerous other aunts, uncles, and cousins, many of whom are here today. Donald, or Dill, I just will mention to you that when we sat together, I needed a separate notebook for all of the names that I heard. And I suspect we might hear a couple more before we're finished here today. He was an inspiration to the many lives he touched. He touched the lives of more people than we will ever know. So it is with great sorrow and pain that we notify his far-reached family, friends, and extended family, you know who you are, of his passing. He loved playing sports growing up and represented his school and South Hill. He excelled in hockey to the ranks of playing junior hockey. Along the way, he received number 4, which will explain the tribute on the back of so many of you here today. His true love was working on the rigs. His hard work and dedication meant him to be top driller. He worked this hard life, extending his career beyond 25 years. But he also loved his mechanics and building his cars and trucks, and had a love for his bikes. That's a surprise. If you couldn't find him, you looked in the garage. Donald also loved to work with concrete, building many masonry structures around Moose Jaw and the area, which we will treasure for our remaining years. In his last 11 years, his daughter was his life. He treasured the moments and the time that he had with her. She was his number one love. Donald's battle with diabetes and heart disease was the only one he ever lost in his life. He wore his name proudly on many jerseys and on his back, always strived for goodness while never looking back. The family gives special thanks to Dr. Jennifer Ellen Baird for her honesty and compassion when it seemed like no one else cared, and to the nurse, Jordan, for taking the time to be his friend at the Regina General Hospital. The family also thanks the owners and staff of the Moose Jaw Funeral Home for all that we do, and from all the other families that rely on the Moose Jaw Funeral Home. Donald's memories will be instilled in us all. I have been present at the reading of many obituaries. Of course, many, I have been the reader. And while it's true that that gives some, you know, sort of, if it was a painting, it would be just a very shadowy outline of who he really was. And I will say that even with words and pictures, we're still going to be filling in, adding color, and we won't be finished, because you can't replace the living, breathing, vital person with words and pictures. However, I heard a lot about Donald's first cousins. I don't know how many of you there are, but Dennis was the one I talked to most. And I'm going to just let you first cousins know, you have a lot that you have to live up to. Many of you have indicated that you would like to speak today, and it's not just all first cousins, but we're going to take a moment to hear from people who knew Donald best. I'm going to call on Dennis to come and to get us started. And of course, we do have the sunset limit to your talking. He told me he could go on for hours, so.
Hey, he's always picking on me still, man.
You know something?
I can't find my Where's mask. Your tie? I was supposed to wear that today. A mask, you borrow mine. Okay. I don't know where to start. First things first, Don was my cousin, he was my friend. I'd like to share a few stories. First things first, we were kids, we were inseparable. Where there was one of us, there was two of us, there was everything. I got a few that stick out. One of the ones that sticks out is Uncle Reiner and Dad taking us to a hockey game one time. We're in the back of the van. Those two are up front. All of a sudden, this car comes flying up beside us, honking and waving, and Uncle Reiner's like, what the heck's going on? He probably doesn't even remember this. He will in a second. All of a sudden, this guy's waving his hands or whatever. Well, me and Don thought it would be a great idea to bring our WWF wrestlers and some fishing line. So we got the back windows on the van, off the sides, and each of us got a wrestler tied to this fishing line. We're dragging it down the highway. It was pretty entertaining. Uncle Reiner, yeah, we got in trouble that day too. Auntie Sherry, one time, still, maybe no fish now, but she was a fine person of fish. And me and Don one day decided that it would be a good idea to take the fish out of the tank. The fish didn't do so well. Auntie Sherry, the next morning, wakes up, comes straight to the bedroom. What the heck did you guys do? Well, needless to say, Auntie made us sit in front of the fish tank for over a day. You guys, not hours, days. Like, she was not happy with us. I could stand here forever, you guys, and tell you a lot of stories. Another one, Dawn, my wedding. That bike of his, holy Nana. It was scary. He was trying to show me how cool it was. Well, it was cool, all right. Cool as heck. Yeah, I don't know. Anyway, I got a poem here that I drummed up for him, and I'd like to read it. Cousin, we made a lot of memories throughout our childhood days. No worries in the great big world. All we did was play. You know you'd have my back, and that I could count on you. Even now, since we've grown up, I know that still is true. I can't even remember the first time I saw your face, but I do know within my life, no one can take your place. We were there for each other, and we'll be to the end. Dawn, by blood, we are cousins. But by our hearts, we are friends and brothers. Okay.
Yeah. Brotherhood. You may be called cousins, but that sounded like a brother to me. We're going to listen now to Kevin Smoltz. Kevin?
I guess like you, Dennis, kind of where does it start? So many good memories of Don. One that sticks out in my mind is he just got this bike. It's like October, let's take this thing for a drive, he says. It's like, you don't want to go through it, have a look at it? Bye, check the air and the tires. All right, And down the road, we go heading towards Belle Plaine, and I'm pointing at Don because I see the front forks flexing off his bike. The bike was cracked. Wouldn't look at me. All he heard was motors going both sides. And so we get up over the bridge, and I said, now we're out here. How are we going to get this bike home? Go to Belle Plaine, grab a ratchet strap, strap the front end of his bike back on, rides it back home. Don, what do you think of this? It's all right, buddy. We made it home. So many memories of Don, like Stockwell, he's a guy that wears his heart on his sleeve. If you weren't motivated, he'd motivate you. And I know there's not really words to say bye to somebody, but you sit down and you think to yourself, how do I say bye? Well, you can't really. But I guess it's goodbye, Don. I love you, buddy.
An incredible guy. We're hearing that he connected and he cared. Raymond Ahrens. Are you? Oh, there you are. If you would come, please.
I guess this kind of caught me by surprise, but you really got to think. One of the nephews posted, why? All I can think about is that his daddy and grandpa need help. He went. That's all I gotta say. Thank you.
Tears, somebody said, are simply memories in motion. And I'm glad that you were able to share tears with us. Love is what produces that kind of heartache. And it was very good of you to share with us. Chad Ozak. Sorry, I'm just looking around for who's who. Chad. The one difficulty is that people are watching and they won't be able to. Yeah. And your head is so shiny.
Everyone's gonna go blind. What do I say about Donnie? I guess the first thing is I got to say when I first met him. I got the pleasure of meeting him and his mom, both on a rage, chasing me down the street thinking I stole his BMX. Because we all know how Donnie and a lot of the guys in here, we all were with our BMXs. And I got the pleasure of Sherry and Donnie chasing me down the street, Sherry shouting these pleasant words at me. Like, I've never heard such pleasant words in my life. I think from that point on, Donnie and I and the family were the best of friends. There's a lot of times I thought that I was actually Donnie's a little retarded buddy. Because every time we'd go to the house, he would say something to piss off his mom. And we all know how Sherry gets. And, well, Donnie, you know how small I am, how big he is. He stands and tries to hide behind me. Like, what am I gonna do when that purse starts swinging? Like, I don't know, he was, best way I can describe Donnie was, the guy was an ox. He was built like one. He worked like one. And if you were a true friend of his, you'd never had to worry because, man, that guy would protect you to the end. And he did with me several times. A couple funny stories with Donnie is growing up, being at the house again. Not like we were ever smart asses to his old man. But he'd always offer us, if we were man enough, to go into the dog kennel with him. If we could crawl out before he did, we'd get the utmost respect from him. And I know everybody knows what I'm talking about. But luckily, I never had to go in there. Because I know I wouldn't be the one coming out. I could go on for a long time about Donnie. We played hockey together. We played lacrosse together. I'll tell you, never in my life of playing sports have I ever seen another team or another team's goalie step out of the way of the net when Donnie takes a shot. And the referee, yes. I'm lucky that referee lived from that one. Yeah, I know in the last couple years, Donnie and I didn't hang out a lot. But we never had to. Donnie and I had a connection where whenever we met, it was like we never missed a beat. It was always the same, and it was always chatty. It was always chatty. It was never anything else. And with me, it was always Donnie. It was no other nickname. It was Donnie. And now I'm thinking I probably should have wrote stuff down. I know I was as far as I know, I was Donnie's auto body buddy that knows how to paint all these nice cars and everything, and he asked me repeatedly about his painting his bike. I never did do it for him, but if for some reason I'm ever asked to redo that bike for him, I'd be more than happy and pleased. We all know what his bike meant to him and what everybody's bikes mean to them. But I can proudly say I'll probably never have one. They don't make them small enough to fit me. I'm not riding a Sportster, no. No. Like I could say, I could go on all day about Donnie and how he always took care of me and I took care of him. We've got a few other good stories that Donnie and I have had together, but I think I'm going to keep those to myself. And I don't know. That's all I have to say for right now.
You can take your sunglasses off now. The shine is gone here for a few moments. Very shortly, Anna Maria is going to come and share something with us. But I've been asked if I would give an opportunity for any of you who haven't had a chance to speak, if you would like to do so. It would just be a reminder that you need to come up to the microphone here because of the people who are watching online. So the invitation is there. I thought you might.
So, like everyone else, I've got lots of stories. Fucking, oh, I guess I shouldn't swear, but good thing it's not a church. But yeah, with Don. Lots of good. One thing that really comes back is going to the lake. all the time. And Nanny had her cabin, the bottom of the hill, and just riding dirt bikes and being barefoot, trying to walk down the road. And my brother and my big cousin always trying to make me tougher. And always got to be barefoot, walking on the asphalt to toughen up your feet. And that was something every summer. It was like they never missed a beat. But while they were going for girls, I was just messing around, fucking on the dirt bike, on the trails, you know. But I'll try and keep it short so I don't swear so much. But another recent memory was I was walking to go get my truck that I left at the bar. And he was sitting there. I can't remember what they were in, if it was a truck or what, but his pork chop was up in the lift, siliconing all these windows on an old folks home across from Crescent Park. And I was walking by, and I thought it was Don. And he jumped out, "Hey, Boo!" As always, that's my family nickname, and never skipped a beat calling me that. And yeah, big hug and big smile always. And you know, it's like even if you didn't see each other for a while, like Chaddy said, you never miss a beat with Don. That's how it was, but he had a good laugh. "I'm getting $50 an hour to sit down here while pork chops up there in the left." And yeah, so got a good laugh about that. But yeah, no, he's a great man, a great cousin, and a great friend. So could get into some fight stories and some brawls that we're cousins and friends have been in at the bars, but you know, that's, if you're in trouble, he would fucking step up. So that's all I got to say. And ride on and ride hard.
So is there someone else, perhaps someone I was meant to call on? Thank you.
It's hard up here. So, going back with Chad, and Jeremy said, "Oh, Don always had your back." This one time, me and Richard are riding BMX, and we got jumped right on Main Street by a carload of guys. And right away we were like, "Holy shit." We got punched around a bit. We're like, "What the hell do we do? These guys are chasing us." And this is when Don lived in Blair's house upstairs. So automatically we take off to Don's house and he's got the window open. We're yelling while these guys are chasing us around with the car and trying to catch us. And yeah, all of a sudden these guys get out, and all of a sudden out comes Don, like stepped right out of the balcony down the stairs, boxers on and steel toe boots. And just the cutoff pool cue, and needless to say, those guys didn't come after us ever again. But yeah, that's one of my best memories with him, and he's always there and had everyone's back, and he's a good man. Thank
you. Your last chance. You don't want to go home, thank you, and say, "I wish I had."
You guys all know, you guys all knew Don. Don is Don. Blunt, straightforward, never pulled any punches with anybody. Since I was a young kid, he took me under his arm, along with the rest of this family. He held us tight no matter where we were, what we were doing. He always wanted the best for us. They took the wrong guy at the wrong time. He's still here. He's still holding us tight, and I don't want anybody to ever forget that. But let's get to some stories. I got to pick on Dennis. So we're a little bit younger. I think I'm about 8. Don's about 11. I might have been a little bit older. We set up this sweet bike track in Auntie Joe's backyard. We lived up on Duffield right behind the house, and there's no fences behind. So we decided we'd build this jump, and we'd set up a bunch of sawhorses behind it, so you can clear the most sawhorses. So we all get on our bikes, and away we go. So, you know, Richard jumps a couple times. He's just a little bit younger than us, so we give him a couple sawhorses, no problem. Sawhorses graduated with the age. So we get to me, and I go and jump him. Dennis jumps on the bike, and he rides up to my backyard, turns around, and Don looks at me and says, "Hey, you want to see a fight today?" I said, "What are you talking about?" He said, "Watch this." So Dennis gets on that bike, and he pedals his ass off, and he hits this jump. He's got about 6 sawhorses to go over. Well, let's say Dennis made about 2 before Don threw a hockey stick, and it went right between his front forks and rolled him over the handlebars. Right into the sawhorse, cleared out the rest. Don says, "I don't think he's going to fight." A lacrosse story, Chad. You said you wish you weren't the goalie that was standing in front of it. Yeah, no, that was me. I was the goaltender in lacrosse. When Don got out on that court, he wasn't all skill. He was he was our enforcer. But you let him throw the ball at you, and let me tell you how he feels. Because he threw one from about the blue line in the hockey rink, and I was in net. I didn't even see the ball. All I heard was thunk. And I looked behind me, and the net was going back and forth. He walks up to me. He's like, "Lucky that didn't hit you, hey?" I said, "Thanks, cuz." "Thanks, man. Yeah, I'm really proud that didn't hit me." So a few years later, we go to Calgary, and we're playing in a tournament. I'm in net. Don's got the ball just inside the blue line, shooting on their goalie. Well, he winds up, and he lets it go. And Don never threw the ball lightly. He threw it as hard as he could. Winds up and rifles this ball. Well, it hooks out of his stick, and it hit the ref straight in the chest. Keeled him over, knocked him over. This is like 3-4 years later. He comes over and looks at me. Says, "Bet you're glad that didn't hit you." Again, yes, I'm glad. Thank you, I'm on your team. Anyhow, guys, like you said, we can go on all day, all night, all year about Don. Just remember, he's looking down on us now. He's smiling. He loves each and every one of us with all his heart, all his soul. And guys, we need to do the same. We love and miss you, buddy. Ride hard.
Thank you. Your really last chance. Anyone else? But they they won't be able to hear you online. Oh. So can you come up? Sure, come on. Yeah, you got to finish it.
Thank you.
Yeah, no worries. All right, I'll try not to get choked up this time, but one thing I always remember as well is always being on the ice. Like, all of us, our whole family played hockey. And Don, like Kyle said, his shot, he never wanted to get in the way. And on the outdoor rink, I used to play net, but I learned the hard way to use a parka, because those frozen orange hockey balls hurt worse than a puck sometimes. And now I got beamed right in the face with one. But before I ramble on, I just remember I was always stick boy. Dennis was goalie. My brother played hockey, and so did Don, and they're usually on the same team. But Don, one thing I always remember is from goal crease to goal crease, wherever he set up, he could take a slap shot and hit the glass at the other end, and that's something I'll never forget, and that's what I strive to do. I was more of a goon in hockey, but I had a slap shot, so I learned that from my big cousin, Don, and yeah.
Thanks again.
Just wanted to share that one.
A couple of you said you could go on for hours or days, and I'm sure that's true. And I really encourage you to share these stories with one another, of course, and directly with his parents and brothers and sisters. Make sure that you celebrate all that he was to you. And somebody has said, well, he's looking down on us now. That may be true, but of perhaps more significance is that he is not there, he's there. And as long as you keep his memory alive, he will not be gone. And I encourage you to do that. We're going to have a look at some pictures that have been put together for us, and then Anna Marie is going to come and share a reading.
Satisfied in the assembly. Oh,
Don't pictures start our memories? And very often, they warm our hearts. I hope that was true for you this afternoon. Now, we're going to hear from his sister. She has a reading and a few words for us.
I'm just going to read a poem titled "For My Big Brother." He showed me a lot of things. I learned a lot I did not know. But he forgot to teach me one thing. That's how to let go. I know you didn't mean to leave me. Sometimes we have no choice. I miss being your little sister, hearing your name call my voice. I wish I got to say I love you before you were given to the sky. If God can grant me one last wish, I'd ask to say goodbye. You always meant a lot to me. I could never love you less. I know when it's true that they say he only takes the best.
When will our hearts be unbroken? Over the course of the next days and weeks, you're going to have to lean back on your strength and on his to keep the relationship whole. It's been asked by his father, Reiner, that we share together in the Lord's Prayer. We're going to do that, and then Reiner is going to come and give a father's tribute. So as we bow our heads and our hearts, let's pray strength for Reiner too. I invite you, if you do not know the words, to look at the screen and repeat together with me. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Reiner.
Bear with me here, guys. I shouldn't have to tell you, this group, there was only one Donald. It is hard. It is a dark time for our family. Hard to find any solace or comfort when we see the hurt in so many eyes. We all know Don was a go-getter. Work or play, when he barked, most would listen, including me. Don's battle was a courageous one. He always looked forward. He was always so worried about his mother, making sure she was comfortable on the many days and nights for the past months. Don wasn't thinking of himself. It was his mother. Always telling me to relax, get sleep, quit smoking. We're gonna beat this. Always forward. He was our inspiration to the strength he showed. I want you all to know he battled to the end. Donald's battle with diabetes and heart disease was the only one he ever lost in life. Don was true blue. He never disguised. You were either his friend or on the other side. Don't Donald's number one love in life was his 11-year-old daughter, Charlie. He cherished his short time spent. He spoke about her all the time, making plans. His pumpkin, that is what he always called her. She was the only pumpkin in the patch, in his eyes. We all wish we could rewind time, but we must all look ahead through all our losses and tragedies in life. Donald's grandparents have called him home. We know he's in their arms. We all shared some great memories, and we will hold these in our hearts to the end of our time. If anybody knew Donald, they knew stubbornness. That was his trait, work or play. That was his way. I would like to think that us, his parents, instilled his courage and motivation in life. One of his last words to us was, stand up, be strong. His mother was the only one to ever make him feel calm. Treasure your time with your children. Make time for your children. Then time is gone. Heaven's gates have opened. His angels appear. His soul is arriving, riding with no fear. Always going forward, never looking behind. His presence will be missed for the rest of our time. Donald will be missed, his strength and his stance. His memory will never fade, bringing many a silent tear. The pain of a mother's loss is no one wanted to be seen, is not one wanted to be seen. Her hurt tears us all right down to the seam. There's no greater loss. Her child is gone. Her strength, we pray, will help us all carry on. A mother's wisdom and love is all that we got. Every family's mother is the family's rock. Donald would not want to see a tear in her eye, instead reflect on all the years gone by. Our tree has been shortened, our biggest branch has fallen. For all our coming years, never to be forgotten. Till we meet again, my son, Mom. On behalf of Sherry, myself, and the rest of our family, we have been overwhelmed with the heartfelt support and respect that has been shown from all that knew Don. You have given us pride to carry forward our love and respect for that. Donald's strength and courage will help us carry on to be engraved in our soul forever when the nights will feel so long. Till we meet again, my son. Don's sister, Anna, and friends have organized this supper tonight where I'm sure many stories will be told and passed on. Be careful, he will be listening. Donald's last ride and burial will be announced later this spring. Till we meet again, my son.
Thank you. We've come to the final moments of our gathering here.
I'm glad that you mentioned the supper that's going to be shared by so many people. Please let those memories continue, because your celebration of Dawn continues as long as you share those stories. So this is our last few moments, and there's one very, very important task left for us. Truly, we come to this time, and it's like he's being ripped from our hands and our hearts. And the only people who can change how that feels are those of us who are left behind. I'm going to pray a blessing on Dawn. And I invite you, if this helps, think of Dawn in the palm of your hand. And as I pray the blessing, just let him go. Do not let him be torn away from you. Let him go. And then we will dismiss from this place. Let's bow our heads and our hearts. Well, Father, it doesn't feel much different from when we began, except that we've had the chance to share all of these memories and to let our hearts expand with love. And so we ask you, really, to bless Dawn. We release him into your care, not because we want to, although we know this is the best place for him, it is still tremendously difficult to let go. But we do. We have done all that we can do, Dawn. And you've left with a big part of each one of us. We let you into heaven with our love and our prayers. We encourage you to ride hard, to meet and love those who have already gone, who are there waiting to meet you. And we ask you to watch over us. We promise you that we will support your parents, your family. We promise you that Charlie will never need to know the support and the strength of this family and friends. And so we let you go. And now for every one of those who are gathered here or online, I pray that God will bless you with his light for your path. I pray that God will bless you with his peace for your heart. And I pray that God will bless you with his love for your every relationship. Go in peace. Amen.
She gets there, she knows you. she's buying a stairway to heaven. There's a sign on the wall, but she wants to be sure, 'cause you know sometimes words have two meanings. In a tree by the brook, there's a song.